friends and family, we gather today in the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to give thanks for the life of Boyd Hector Smith, to remember the ways that his life touched ours, to entrust him to God's keeping, and to receive the comfort of the Holy Spirit, and also to proclaim the good news of eternal life in Jesus Christ. The psalmist writes this, he says, "Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Those he redeemed from trouble and gathered in from the lands, from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Some were sick through their sinful ways, and because of their iniquities endured affliction. They loathed any kind of food, and they drew near the gates of death. Then they cried to the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them from their distress. He sent out his word and healed them and delivered them from destruction. Let them thank the Lord for his steadfast love, for his wonderful works to humankind. And let them offer thanksgiving and sacrifices and tell of his deeds with songs of joy." Friends, when we were baptized in Jesus Christ, we were baptized into his death. We were buried with him so that as Christ was raised from the dead in glory, so we too might be raised to a new life. For if we've been united with Christ in a death like his, surely we will be raised to life in a resurrection like his. Friends, let us pray together. Eternal God, maker of heaven and earth, you formed us from the dust of the earth. By your breath, you've given us life. We glorify you. Jesus Christ, the resurrection and life, you tasted death for all of humanity. By rising from the grave, you opened the way to eternal life, and we praise you. Holy Spirit, author and giver of life, you are the comforter of all who mourn, our sure confidence and everlasting hope. We worship you. To you, O blessed Trinity, be glory and honor forever and ever. Amen. Friends, let us stand in body or in spirit and lift our voices together in song. invite you to hear the word of God. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but may have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are already condemned because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and the people love darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so that their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us now join together and ask God to cleanse our hearts and to redeem our memories and to renew our confidence in the goodness of God. I'll offer a prayer followed by a brief moment of silence, and I invite you to pray with me using the words that are printed in our bulletin as we lift this prayer of confession together. So friends, let us pray. God, forgive us and help us to forgive others. Heal us from the pain of self-condemnation. Free us from the burden of failures that cannot be corrected. Renew us with your loving assurance that our sins have been forgiven through Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen. God, hear now the prayers we lift to you in the silence of our hearts. Friends, hear the good news. Who's in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. And Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone away and a new life has begun. So friends, know that you are forgiven and be at peace. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This time, I invite Laura to come forward and start off our time of celebration of life and God's promises.
Thank you for being with us today. We wish to celebrate a wonderful man whose entire life has been dedicated to his family and his community. A devoted husband to one, a wonderful father to two, a loving grandfather to four, and a brother, father-in-law, uncle, and friend to so many. What a truly extraordinary life my grandfather lived. Today I wish to share some words about the man who has been an integral part of my life. To say that I'm lucky to be one of his grandchildren is an understatement. It is a blessing that I'm truly grateful for and will be for the rest of my life. It is a challenge to speak today, to put into words the many things that I would like to say about him and what he meant to me. My grandfather, or Papa, as we affectionately called him, loved people. He could strike up a conversation with anyone at any time. He genuinely loved hearing about people's lives and wanted to know their stories. An example of this was at my high school orientation. He wanted to come with us, and within 30 minutes, he had met a resource officer who was from Morganton. They struck up a conversation and knew many of the same people. That resource officer always said hello to me and asked about my grandfather throughout the remainder of my time in high school. Many times when my family and I would come visit, we would lose track of Papa in Grace Ridge because he would be off talking to someone else, whether they lived there or were just visiting. He loved eating in the dining room with his friends. Those times meant so much to him. Papa loved people, and they loved him too. The memories I have of Papa will always stay with me. One of them is how he helped teach me how to drive. I'm sure there isn't an empty parking lot in Morganton that we haven't practiced in together. Anytime we would take him to Walmart, he would zoom off using his walker, and it would take four people to track him down, just because he was so quick. He loved tomatoes and would always ask for us to bring him some from the small market up the road. When my family and I would go to West Jefferson to get our Christmas tree, we would pick up Papa so he could join us at Chalet Springs. The joy of watching him partake in an all-you-can-eat buffet with country ham included still makes me laugh to this day. We love taking him to the park for picnics and hearing about his time in the Army. I may not remember every detail, but I know he was so proud to serve his country. I love talking about our travels and hearing about the places he had been. My family and I especially loved our time at the beach with my grandparents. My grandmother Mimi would sit on the sand and watch as Papa played in the water with my sisters and I. Sarah, Elizabeth, and I loved those times with him. He made each of us feel so special. And most importantly, I would call him before every Carolina basketball game to remind him to watch his beloved team. I'm a diehard Duke fan, and we would jokingly bicker about which team was better. He always talked about his respect for Duke and Coach K. I just teased him about how I would pull for Russia before I would pull for Carolina. Not now. He would just shake his head and wonder how we were related. We had many FaceTime calls, and Papa would love to talk to our dog, Stella. It was important to him that she remembered him and knew who he was, which was so sweet. He would pronounce her name Stella and always ask about her. He cared about the things that were important to each of us. He was always kind and thoughtful. Those were just a few of my favorite moments. My grandfather always encouraged me, especially when it came to my work. He was so proud that I was a public school teacher and would always ask about school each and every time we talked. He would ask about the students, and I'd share funny stories. Papa would talk about how teachers deserved a raise, and I would tell him, "You should go run for office." He would encourage me on rough days and tell me to stick with it because it is a noble and worthy profession. He believed I was making a difference, and that means the world to me. My grandfather loved the Lord and taught me to appreciate the moments we have on earth. I know he is in heaven and that I will see him again one day. I hope he knows how much he has meant to each of us. Something I said to my grandfather often, "Which you were one of my favorite people in the whole wide world." And he was. Papa loved others the way Christ loves us. He emitted joy and light each and every day, and because of that, I am who I am. I will carry that joy and light with me and hope to share it with others the way he shared it with me. He will always be with us. And if I could just say one more thing to Papa, it would be go Tar Heels.
Thank y'all so much for coming. That means so much to us. It really does. John had asked me did anybody else want to say anything today, and I said, I'll let you know. This was last week when we talked to him, and like I do most things, like it was up until the last minute. I think it was a couple of minutes before we walked in here.
Yeah.
Okay, I've decided I'm going to say something. And I don't have anything written down. I'm just going to speak, you know, from the heart. But then as I was sitting here, I thought, I can't remember stuff nowadays. So I jotted down a few quick notes. Melissa and I were both lucky to have such wonderful parents. And I can remember many times praying to God and thanking him for such wonderful parents and for that wonderful start that he gave us in our lives. And, you know, they were gracious to welcome our friends into our homes when we were younger and to let our house be the place where people could hang out and the kids could gather and have their fun and stuff, you know. And I'm lucky to have some friends that were that same way. I love my friends, their parents were just like mom and dad were. And that's a great way to grow up and a great way to learn how to raise your own kids, you know, to to be open to their friends and to have them come into your home. And Mom and Dad were so much like that. You know, Mom and Dad taught us how to deal with people and how to be social in situations. And they also instilled in me a wonderful work ethic. You know, Mom and Dad both, for most of their careers, a lot of their careers worked for the state employment. And you hear a lot of things about state employees, you know, and how there's one guy working and four or five guys standing around. And Mom and Dad didn't get the memo on that because they were both dedicated hard workers and did their best to do their job that needed to be done the way it should be done. And that's the work ethic that I got from them, and I'm thankful for that. You know, Dad loves people. That's no secret. And he loved meeting people, just like Laura said, making a connection with people from somewhere that you never know. I could go about anywhere and talk to a stranger or meet somebody, and I said, you know, if my dad was here right now, y'all would probably know somebody in common, or even know something about where you're from or your family. It was always such a neat feeling to go places, like at meetings for our condo association or gatherings, you know, regarding whatever, and people would say, oh, your dad's voice now. Oh, he's the nicest guy. I just love him, you know, and I knew it was genuine. Friday, I was over at Grace Ridge. I was pushing in a hand truck with a couple of boxes because we're boxing up some stuff, you know, and it was raining. And so I came in the door. There was a girl in there I'd not met before, and she said, excuse me, can I help you? I probably looked like a delivery guy coming in or something, you know. And I said, oh, no. I said, I'm David Smith. I said, I'm Boy Smith's son. And instantly, her name was Jamie. She stopped and she said, oh, I just love your dad. She said, I remember he was one of the first people I met when I started this job. And he came up to me and welcomed me and made me feel welcome in my new job. And it's just such a good feeling to hear, you know. And I can really hope to hear just a portion of those good things, you know, about me as I grow up on up in my life. I'm not a boastful or cocky person, but you know, you go to funerals and it makes you think, maybe this is an odd thought, but I think, gosh, I wonder how many people will come to my funeral when I die, you know, how many people will make the effort or whatever. And again, I'm not cocky, but I knew there would be a good crowd here at Dad's funeral, just because he took so many lives and so many people meant a lot to him, and he meant a lot to those people. And that's just a wonderful thing to say. Dad was a great Christian. He was strong in his faith. Mom and Dad both were. Never wavering. And that's another thing that I learned from him and that I got from him. And I know that when he got to heaven a couple weeks ago, he was greeted at the door, being told, well done, good and faithful servant.
Thank you all so much for sharing. Friends, our scripture reading for today comes from Paul's letter to the Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 1 through 10, and I invite you to hear God's word again. You were dead through the trespasses and the sins in which you once lived, following the course of this world, following the ruler of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work among those who are disobedient. All of us once lived among them in the passions of our flesh, following the desires of flesh and senses, and we were by nature children of wrath like everyone else. And then my favorite conjunction in the whole Bible. But God. But God, who is rich in mercy, out of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead through our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, so that in the ages to come he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not the result of works, so that no one may boast. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Boyd Smith was one of a kind. In fact, he might have been one in a million. Boyd was kind and gracious and caring. He was a regular worshiper with us here at First Presbyterian Church, and it seemed that every time the doors were open, Boyd Smith was here. Right back there. The only time I saw Boyd really frustrated or upset, I'm sure there were other times, but the only time that I saw it was when the kind folks at Grace Ridge would no longer allow him to come over here. He was not happy about that. You see, it was no fault of their own. It was intended for his safety and protection, but Boyd wanted to be here. More than anything, Boyd wanted to be here. Boyd loved the people of this church, and they loved him right back. As news of Boyd's passing made the rounds through social media and the newspapers and all those kinds of things, folks would begin to share stories and memories and condolences and their sympathies, and they came pouring in through posts and whatnot, and I wanted to share just a few of those that I saw. One person wrote, "Boyd was such a great guy and a friendly person." Another, "Boyd brought joy to everyone he met. His sweet smile will definitely be missed." "I will miss Boyd. I love talking with him at church and when visiting Grace Ridge." Finally, one person wrote, "A true gentleman who exemplified the love of Christ." For me, I have two favorite memories of Boyd. The first was that Boyd would often call the church offices. He was very concerned that he had not paid his pledge or whatever, and he just wanted to make sure. So once every week and a half or so, he would call the office. And in the office, we had a little game where whoever Boyd would talk with, you know, as soon as we'd get off the phone, we would hang up and we would run and be like, "He called me this time," right? For the record, I won more than I lost. But one of my favorite memories is that it's a simple thing, but every time I would talk with Boyd and he would hang the phone, he would have that distinctive voice. Yeah. And he'd say, all right, Diane, I love you. And then he would hang up. It was something so small, but he told me he loved me. How many of you get to hear that often? It was great. He wasn't mine. He sat right back there. He was one of the people that I shepherd, but he would hang up. Now, towards the end, I don't know if he thought I was David. I don't know what he thought, but I'm going to own that. I'm going to take it, if that's okay. And I'm going to hold it for a long, long time. The second was the last time that I got to see Boy when he was still aware. I visited Grace Ridge, and one of our staff members, Lindsay, she got to go with me, and we went over to Grace Ridge and visited Boyd. And Boyd always loved to be outside. He always wanted to be out of his room and heading outside. And one of the favorite places that he has was the little courtyard that's there in Grace Ridge. And it has a little fish pond. And he loved being out there. First off, yes, it was very hard to keep up with him. So we sat outside. He was already on his walker and out the door, and we were... So we had to chase him down. It was a beautiful day, and it was odd because it was so late in the year to have such a beautiful day. But we were outside, the sun was shining. I remember I had to wear sunglasses because it was just such a beautiful, beautiful day. We're sitting there, and he's telling stories, and he told us he was so happy to have made it to 71 years old. And it was our pleasure to tell him, "Boyd, today is your day because the news is even better. My friend, you are 91. He gave me a little Barney Fife sniff. Yeah, I made it. Yeah. Well, never forget, we're enjoying conversation. Boyd's telling us all kinds of stories about his family and friends and things that are going on in his life. And he pauses and he kind of looks up in the sky, and it was, again, just a beautiful day. Not a cloud in the sky. He looks up and he's just kind of taking it all in, you know? And all of a sudden he looked down and he made eye contact with me. He said, you know, I don't think I'm going to be around much longer. Of course, he kind of caught me off guard. I just had to tell him he was 20 years older than he really was. So I didn't know if he was, you know, oh boy. So I like to joke with him, oh boy, you're looking strong, man. You're going to be around for a lot longer. Don't worry, you know. He's trying to build him up. He said, no, only a couple more weeks, I think. He said, you know what? That's okay. It's time. I'm ready. You know, looking back, that moment gives me such comfort and peace knowing that he knew and that he was ready and that he was at peace. The next time that I saw Boyd, he wasn't able to respond, and I don't know if he even knew I was there. But I told him that I loved him and that he was loved by many, many people here. And then I would see him again soon. You know, we've done far too many of these in the last 3 years. But I've grown fond of saying this every time we get together to bear witness to the resurrection. And it goes something like this, you know. Bearing witness to the resurrection at the end of our lives doesn't necessarily mean that we pick out all the best moments of our life to highlight. Even though that's well and good. When we gather to bear witness to the resurrection, we recognize God's grace in the midst of all of life, the good and the bad, the beautiful and the messy, what we're proud of and what we would dare not share with anyone else. In the midst of all that life brings, we recognize that God's steadfast love endures forever. Those of us on this side of eternity, we cast our whole heart onto God's amazing grace. And we remember that we are all in need of a Savior whose name is Jesus. We were all trespassers at one point or another, but God. By God's grace, you and I have been called into a different kind of life. You know, I give thanks that what the scriptures say is true, that though Boyd surely suffered many trials, he endured. His faith is now sight. He's experiencing indescribable and immeasurable and glorious joy. Boyd has received the gift of God, the salvation of his soul. Not because he was a great guy, even though he was. Not because he told me he loved me, even though he did. Not because of any of that. But only because of God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ. His is an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading. The scriptures proclaim that upon that cross, Jesus Christ died and bore the weight of sin and death. Because of his self-sacrificial love, you and I have been set free. Because of what God did through Christ, through his death, burial, resurrection, and ascension, we have been granted the righteousness of God. We have been called children of God and joint heirs with Christ. You see, I believe with my whole heart what the scriptures say is true. Neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God and Jesus Christ. All of my faith is wrapped up in this. All of my life is wrapped up in this truth and this hope. And nothing can separate us from God's steadfast love. God's unmerited, undeserved, never failing covenant love that endures forever. My friends, may you find peace and comfort today. May you be flooded with memories of our precious one, Boyd Smith. May you remember the way that his life made a difference in yours. And in turn, may you and I look to make a difference in someone else's life as well. It's my prayer for you, and my prayer for me. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Friends, I invite us to stand in body and spirit again as we lift our song to the Lord. let's affirm our faith using the words of Psalm 23 printed in your bulletin. We'll say these in unison together. Church, what we believe. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Friends, let us pray. O God, before whom generations rise and pass away, we praise you for all of your servants who, having lived this life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we give you thanks for your servant Boyd, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace that you gave him and kindled in him the love of your dear name, and enabled him to serve you faithfully. We thank you that for him death is past and pain is over, that he has now entered the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the Lord's Prayer, the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. In the sure and certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life, through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend Boyd Smith to Almighty God. Blessed are the dead who die, and the Lord says the Spirit, they rest from their labors, and their works follow them. Friends, let's pray again. Creator God, maker of all, we are formed of the dust of the earth, and you ordained to dust we shall return. All of us go down to the dust, and even at the grave we make our song, singing Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Give rest, O God, to your servant Boyd with all of your saints, where there is no pain, there is no sorrow, there is no sighing, but there is life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Boyd. Acknowledge, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. Friends, we'll sing again, How Great Thou Art.
The hymn is found at number 625. Number 625.
Thank you.
My friends, as we conclude our service today, may your minds be filled with fond and loving memories of Boyd. May your hearts be full of gratitude for God's never-ending and steadfast love. As we prepare to leave this place, the family invites you to join them for light refreshments in our fellowship hall. If you'll follow us as we recess out of the sanctuary, we'll go clear across and walk straight till we can't walk straight anymore, and you'll run into the cookies. That's where you want to be. And so, friends, as we conclude our time together, bearing witness to the resurrection and giving thanks to God for the life of Boyd Smith, receive God's blessing. May the love of God, the abiding grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forever.